minutes from May 20th, 19th.
May I second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, great.
Abstained, yes.
Yes, thank you, abstained. So we also had our regular meeting from June 3rd, Tom is not present. Can I get a motion to approve those as written for the adjustment?
Motion to approve regular meeting minutes from June 3rd, 19th.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Pass, welcome to our, this is our public comments from our visitors, we now will recognize our visitors. Please raise your hand if you wish to speak. When called upon, please use the podium, clearly state your name and address into the microphone, and limit your comments to 3 minutes. Any dialogue must be conducted through me as president of council, although your comments or questions can be addressed to the council, administration, or board. So, anyone else? All right, we'll start with this side. Oh, yeah. If it's on an agenda, we're gonna, we'll have to address the legislation before we get on our legislation, so there's a, okay, yes.
Do you have to speak on something specific?
Do I?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I'm not speaking on legislation.
Okay.
Oh, come on, I'm sorry. Your name and address, please.
William Baxter, 661 Way. May 19th and 19th up to June 9th and 19th, there's 3 shootings in my front door by my house. I'm fed up with it. My property is sacred. The last shooting, I walked my grandkids across the street. About 2 minutes later, we either got hit by a car or beat by gunfire. Something needs to be done in this town. I'm not going to put up with it anymore. That's all I'm going to say about it. Somebody needs to do something.
Mike Faye, 182 West Nichols Street. Just quick on the new business about the vacant lot grass, trying to increase it from 12 inches, or sorry, decrease it to 6 inches. I feel if that goes forward, we should be able to have a small storage building on site, or maybe bring the grass level up to what the other cities in the county do, 28 inches. I think 6 inches from 12 inches is not unreasonable, but on a rainy season this year, I think it's the wrong season to talk about. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to move into our committee reports, planning commission.
Good evening. On June 13th, the planning commission met. There was one new business item, which was a design review appeal for property at 86 Mentor Avenue. The planning commission approved the refusal to allow the property owner to do some changes and modifications to the historical building. Under our administrative report, the Emerald Point Cluster Development received a favorable recommendation for a preliminary plat. This would allow cluster development over over 5 acres of property off of Richmond Street that are going into Fairport. And under administrative report, we had a temporary structure in use that was granted for Grand River Baptist Church, allowing them to use the property at 608 South State Street, which is 1 High Tech Avenue, on a temporary basis for 1 year. That recommendation had 6 stipulations, as well as the cluster development had 2. So this information was emailed out to the clerk this afternoon.
Thank you.
Yes.
Question.
Was there, I did not have an opportunity to attend, and I know that General Point Development is over behind Gloria and myself. Was there any resident or any opposition?
Nobody got up and spoke.
Okay. And you didn't receive any correspondence or anything?
No, we did not.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Thank you. Finance Committee.
The Finance Committee met again, and just to refresh people's memory, the council people that sit on the Finance Committee are Lori, Christine, and myself. We met with the city administration right before this meeting. We had asked them to take a look at some numbers. We know that several years ago that the city council passed an $8, this is for residents, capital fee, and that generated about $1.2 million a year. that was, and that would have solved quite a few of the challenges and opportunities that we have, because again, council has tried to give the administration the foresight to make sure that before we do roads, that we take a look at the water lines. Because I think people that have been on council, if you remember over on Elm Street, the water lines were, I think, 6-inch water lines, maybe 4-inch, and the corrosion of them was probably 3 inches. And we are, you know, trying to stay ahead with water lines as we do our roads, and we have been aggressive with those. Over the last several years, because of the condition of the lake, our intake was, and I think it's 1,100 feet out, due to the, not this year, but due to previous years, the level of the lake was lower, and it caused problems in the wintertime with ice covering over, and then in the summertime with the debris and algae blooms and things of that nature. So currently we're boring out to 4,000, and that project, when it originally started, was about $8 million, and I think it's probably going to end up more to the tune of about $17 million, of which we qualify for an interest-free loan from Ohio. So it is savings considerably. The concern that we're running into is that the plant is older, personnel, EPA is requesting additional chemicals and processing of the water. If you remember Flint, Michigan, that was water that obviously caused health hazards and up around that area. So I guess what the thinking of the Finance Committee was that we would request that the administration come back on our meeting in July to give a presentation on an option as to what could be done with the capital improvement fee and maybe water rate. The water rates is said hasn't really increased since 2011. So the rest of council, you'll be contacted by one of the three people on the Finance Committee to kind of give you a little bit more heads up on some information. And then, as usual, if we do happen to go in that direction, there would be three readings, and we would get it out in front of the public so that they are aware of what direction we might head for their info. And I guess, Christine, Laura, is there anything else you wanted to add, or?
I'm good.
Any questions?
Thank you.
I think that was more than 3 minutes, so my time is up.
All right, thank you. We're moving to legislation. If you wish to comment on legislation, you must request to do so at this time. Those making such a request will be called upon after the reading. Any dialogue must be conducted through me as President of Council. All voting comments or questions can be addressed to the Council or Administration or poll. When called upon, please use the podium. Remember, clearly state your name and address into the microphone and limit your comments to 3 minutes. So I'll run down the legislation if anyone wants to speak. Ordinance number one. Ordinance number two. Ordinance number three. Resolution number four. Resolution number five. Resolution number six. Resolution number seven. Resolution number eight. Resolution number nine. We'll move into ordinance number three for our third reading. What's that?
Ordinance number two.
I'm sorry. Ordinance number one, third reading.
Ordinance number one is going to a public hearing at 8.
Okay, so do you have the comments or do you want to tell you?
Lisa Pete.
Okay, well, we'll hear.
We'll do the reading in a second.
Okay, great. Ordinance number two, third reading.
Maybe she's speaking now.
We're waiting for ordinance number.
Okay.
All right, ordinance number three, first reading.
Sorry, hold on. We're doing ordinance number two, correct?
No, three.
Why aren't we doing ordinance number two?
It's not part of the public hearing, is it?
We're not, right, we're not.
All right, number two, third reading.
An ordinance to approve and adopt the 2019A codified ordinances, including new matter contained therein, and declaring an emergency. These are ready to be, this is ready to be adopted. They've been approved by department heads, and this is the third reading.
Adopt.
Second.
Mrs. Shue?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. Stanello?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Boder?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. Ordinance number two passed. Ordinance number three, first reading.
An ordinance to authorize the city manager to enter into an agreement with American Municipal Power Inc. regarding the advanced metering infrastructure program.
So I'll speak on this briefly tonight, and then Mike, and then Jack will come on May 2 and do a full presentation. Did you want Mike's comments first before I go into talking about it?
Sure. Quick questions.
Basically, just.
How long?
Oh, name matters.
531 South Station, right there. How long until it would have fully anticipated? And then, if my understanding is correctly, I believe it's up money side a couple years ago. I was wondering if that money is sitting somewhere in the interest. And if it is, what's the interest going? Will it be put back as a product, or will it go to some other area of funds?
So the funds are encumbered, so they're not.
It isn't. They are invested. Yes.
Okay.
It's available and it's invested.
But then just go to some fund somewhere else, or we can stay with the project?
It's going to stay in the fund, not necessarily with the project.
Any idea how long until we're fully operational?
So I will answer that in the bullet points in the.
Thank you, Monica.
Yep. Okay, so just a brief history. We started talking about automated metering infrastructure for our electric fund back in January of 2017. We've done a lot of research. Our first presentation to council was November of 17. We did four separate presentations at council through either council meetings or work sessions. We did a road trip to Wadsworth to look at their automated metering infrastructure and asked all the tough questions of them. We also did town hall meetings in June and July of last year. And then in August of last year, council passed a resolution to do our due diligence with AMP. So what we're bringing forth tonight and over the next three reads is the AMI project through AMP. We budgeted $4 million for the AMI system and a new financial system. Phase one of the implementation will be approximately $2.6 million. This is approximately $1.4 million for 12,000 new meters to go in throughout our system. The rest is network infrastructure and installation, field tools and installation, data export development, testing and automation, project management and professional services. There's a 10% contingency for all the delivery of the equipment and a 10% contingency on the entire phase one. If this goes through council, we will start in the fall of this year. The implementation of phase one will take approximately 12 to 18 months, depending on how well it goes. And then phase two starts in 2021, and this is the financial software implementation. This will cost about $250,000, and it will take the meter data management system, software licensing, the deployment of that system, and then the merging and full integration with the new financial software. And that will also pay for project management, professional services, and a 10% contingency. The ongoing cost for phase one and phase two throughout the next couple of years will cost about $140,000 a year. And that's AMI program management, professional services, meter data management, system licenses and support, customer service platform, application and integration licenses. And we built in a potential for some cellular carrier charges, but we'll most likely be using fiber. All of this, $150,000 a year, with a cap annual escalation of 3% if necessary, also covers all the cybersecurity, the intrusion protection, storage of the data and secure locations, and a backup location, and software upgrades throughout the time frame of the contract. So that's just a brief overview. Like I said, Jeff will be doing a full-out presentation on this.
Questions from council? We'll leave this on first reading. Resolution number 4, third reading.
A resolution declaring the amount of taxes that may be raised by levy at the maximum rate authorized by law without a vote of the electors to be insufficient and declaring the necessity to levy a 2.5 mil tax in excess of the 10 mil limitation for the purpose of hiring new officers, police capital expenses, police operating expenses, and police wages and benefits used directly in the operation of a police department for the city of Painesville and declaring an emergency.
Okay, this is the third reading. This is to place a police levy, a 2.5 mil police levy on the November 5th ballot. 2.5 mil levy will generate just over $600,000 each year. And these monies will go towards capital costs, operating expenses, additional officers, and possible raises for the police department as well.
Concerns or?
Move to adopt.
Second.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. Resolution number 4 passed. Resolution number 5, second reading.
A resolution authorizing the city manager to enter into a compensation agreement with the Painesville City Local School District for Community Reinvestment Area number 5.
Painesville City Council passed Resolution 4218 on November 19th of 2018, establishing CRA Area Number 5. This legislation now authorizes the city manager to enter into a compensation agreement for the CRA Area Number 5 for any commercial projects that exceed $1 million in payroll pursuant to the provisions of the Ohio Revised Code that are within that. The compensation agreement outlines that the school board is willing to accept 20% of the income tax generated from this new CRA for those entering into agreement with the city to locate or expand business activity within this area. And the school, I did attend the school board meeting on June 10th, and they did approve that at their meeting.
Great. Any questions? Thank you, motion.
Will this suspend?
Second.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mr. Heck?
Yes.
Move to adopt.
Second.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Heck?
Resolution, yes. Resolution number 5 passed. Resolution number 6, first reading.
A resolution authorizing and directing the city manager to advertise for bids and enter into a contract, including any and all ensuing change orders with the lowest and best bidder for the Watson Waterline construction and declaring an emergency.
Good evening. A little history. The Watson Waterline replacement project will provide an important loop from Jackson Street to Manor Avenue. If you're not familiar, it's the backside of Burgess Maple. That will improve main maintain the flow to the downtown area in the event of a water main break. In addition, flow volume and pressure will improve to the downtown area and the surrounding area for fire service. I brought this to you before for CDBG funding a couple readings ago. Purchasing grant funding from CDBG has been awarded in the amount of $74,000 from the county. City funding through water capital totals $89,000, so the total project's $163,900. Staff recommends legislation be approved for this water line project. And hopefully we can do an emergency because we're ready to bid.
Suspend.
Second.
Thank you.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Schub?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes.
Move to adopt.
Second.
Mrs. Schub?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. Resolution number 6 passed. Resolution number 7, first reading.
A resolution adopting the 2020 tax budget for the city of Paintsville, Ohio, and declaring an emergency.
Hello again.
Alright, this is an annual piece of legislation. It has to be approved by July 16th, so we're asking that it gets suspended. It shows the county that basically we need a property tax money. Real quick, so we know that's up at 8 o'clock. So we'll estimate property taxes we expect to receive in 2020, just under $1.8 million. It's basically the same amount of property taxes we're going to receive in 2019. The general fund, we expect to receive $515,000 in property tax revenues. This is the same amount we received in 2019. I do want to point out that if our expenses increase by 3% in the general fund and the revenues are basically the same, we could be looking at over a $550,000 deficit in 2020 in the general fund. In 2019, the general fund had a $200,000 budget deficit. The bond retirement funds, we expect to bring in about $60,000 in property taxes. The police and fire pension funds, we expect to bring in $65,000. The fire levy fund, we expect to bring in just over $100,000 in property taxes. And then the new fire levy, that brings in roughly $320,000 a year. And the new road levy will bring in just over $650,000 next year. And again, I'm requesting to suspend the reading so we can get this approved to the county by July 16th.
Move to suspend.
Second.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Schub?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes.
Move to adopt.
Second.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Schub?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. Resolution number 7 passed. Resolution number 8, first reading.
A resolution declaring certain real estate owned by the city as no longer needed for municipal purposes and authorizing the city manager to sell or lease said real estate to MCP2 LLC and declaring an emergency. Not that one.
Number 8. Transfer of property.
180.
160. At 160 South St. Clair Street to Lake County Land Reward Utilization Corporation. That's it.
Land Utilization Corporation, declaring an emergency.
The resolution before you would allow us to transfer property
that we acquired at 160 South St. Clair Street to the Lake County Land Reutilization Corp. As council may remember, we acquired the property to ensure a unified development of the former Lake East Hospital site in 2017. With the intent of transferring that to a developer should they be interested in the future in developing the property. We've made the Lake County Land Reutilization Corp aware that we would be submitting it for demolition for 2019. Typically, a portion of that, if the city maintains it, is paid by the city, and a portion is paid by the land bank. When we presented it to the land bank, Executive Director John Rogers recommended that we transfer the property over to the land bank because they had neighborhood initiative program funding that would fund the entire amount of the demolition. So based on that, we are requesting that we transfer it over. The land bank is required to keep the property before they can transfer it back to the city or work with us in transferring it to a developer for 3 years. They did state that worst case scenario that if it was prior to that 3 years and we found a developer for the property, the developer or the city would have to pay is half the demolition cost, which is basically $5,805. So we're recommending that we waive second and third readings and move forward with this tonight in order to allow the transfer so that the land bank can get it torn down as soon as possible.
Questions or comments? Motion.
Move to suspend.
Second.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mrs. Shue?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes.
Mrs. Shue?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
We need a motion to adopt.
I'm sorry.
Move to adopt.
Really excited. Really excited. Yeah.
Second.
Mrs. Shue?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. Resolution number 8 passed. So we're going into our public hearing, so I'm not going to move on to this legislation.
This evening, and it does have the address of 760 Oak Street.
The ownership of the property was transferred to Lake Geogga Recovery Centers in January of 2019, and the property has a total combined lot area of 3.61 acres. And as you can see, it has two zoning classifications. This is an aerial showing the location. As you can see, it's vicinity. The Elm Street School is up there on the lot, and there is a lot of vacant land to the east. The eastern end of Oak Street is undeveloped. It consists of vacant land, some of which has an agricultural designation. The rezoning of the 3.61 acres from the M1 and R1 districts to B1 is in harmony with the existing character of the property. As you can see, because of the area to the east that they currently own. So the largest portion of the parcel is zoned M1, light industrial, which is not in harmony with the existing character of the neighborhood. The additional acreage combined with the existing property gives the property owner approximately 10 acres of developable land. The B1 business residential is intended as a transition zoning from commercial to residential. Although the facilities are residential that they're proposing in nature, providing transitional living for individual undergoing treatment, the concern was with the number of facilities on this street. As I noted, the planning commission minutes were supplied to the council, and this planning commission, as they reviewed the rezoning, they were mostly concerned with the rezoning only, because any use of property in the future would have to receive a public hearing for a conditional use permit to allow any of the uses that they propose. And the applicant this year is to have.
We have the four people that put their hands up. Come up individually and say your name and address, please.
Melanie Lasso, 651 Cheryl Drive. First, I just want to thank the council for giving us the opportunity to present our request tonight. And just for the sake of some background, Lake Geogga Recovery Center is a private nonprofit corporation, and we've been providing continuous service to the community since 1971. And we provide services to adults whose lives have been affected by their own or another's use of drugs or alcohol, problem gambling, or mental illness. Our mission statement is to promote lifelong recovery from addiction through education, prevention, and treatment, regardless of ability to pay. Our funders include the Lake County Alcohol, Drug Addiction, and Mental Health Services Board, United Way of Lake County, United Way of Geogga County, the Geogga Board of Mental Health and Recovery Services. We also have a number of state grants. We accept Medicaid, Medicare, private insurance, and self-pay. So since its beginning in 1971, Lake Geogga Recovery Center has earned a really good reputation as far as providing quality and effective outpatient residential treatment, where our clients achieve a success rate that is significantly higher than the national average. We currently operate three outpatient offices, one in Mentor, one in Painesville, and one in Chardon. And we have a wide array of outpatient services at those three locations. We also operate the only long-term residential treatment facilities in Lake Geogga County. And we have been since 1971. There are many kinds across the state who do not have residential treatment. So Angel is rich in this resource that they have this facility to provide long-term residential treatment. We are proposing, as Lynn mentioned, we are proposing to build a new residential substance use disorder treatment facility on Oak Street. And this facility would be 24-bed facility, four of which would be used for withdrawal management. The need for this project is indisputable. For years, we have had a waiting list. And even it being maintaining occupancy at all of our facilities of between 90% and 95% continuously. I think for anybody who knows anything about addiction or has a family member who has struggled with the disease of addiction, and maybe years you've watched this and you have a family member who finally says, yes, I'm ready to accept help, and you call Lake Geogga Center and you say, yeah, you called the right place. We can help you here. But you have to wait 3 weeks to get into treatment. I can't imagine what heartache a parent feels or a spouse feels when they make that phone call and they finally get to the point that their loved ones are going to accept treatment. So our goal in doing this is if not to reduce the waitlist, is to eliminate altogether. So people are ready to accept help. We're really there to help them and to be available to them. In our packet, I just wanted to, you should also have letters of support that we received from this project from Kim Frazier, the executive director of the Lake County Adams Board, Jennifer McCarty, who's the executive director of United Way, and Senator Jenna. So one of the other things I wanted to mention, at the Planning Commission, there were some concerns raised by neighbors. And I can honestly say I've worked at Lake Jones for 15 years and I never once have received a phone call from any neighbors about concerns that were raised. But nonetheless, we took them very seriously. Oh.
Sorry.
Oh, good. We've got a lot more to talk about now. We did want to address their concerns, so we set up an informational meeting for, well, we sent the invitation out to 60 residents, and these were people who were in the 400-foot radius of the property. And that was on May 30th, and we held it at Oak House, which is our Rivers Residential Treatment Facility. And out of those 60 people, 9 people attended the informational session, and those 9 people represented 5 different properties. So just to tell you about their concerns and how we address their concerns, one of the biggest concerns that was mentioned at that information session, not at the Planning Commission, was water and the stormwater issue. They have expressed concern, I believe, to the city on a number of occasions about there not being any storm sewers. Obviously, we're going to be working very closely with our engineer, who will work very closely with the city engineer in the design of this. And we're definitely not doing anything to worsen that project and anything about that problem. The longer with anything, we would hope to perhaps reduce that problem with the issue of water. We have, when we built Oak House on Oak Street, had a similar situation. We do have a detention basin there. Also, just to let you know that we had an information session when we built Oak House in 2015. And we had that right down the street in Elm Street, invited all the neighbors. We had 3 people come to that information session. So trying to be proactive and letting folks know what we're doing and what the needs are. The other concern that was raised about our residents walking down the street. There were complaints that they were throwing cigarette butts, they were throwing trash, they were loud. So we stopped them walking down the street right after that meeting. I think within a day or 2, we stopped them walking down the street. I'm a big advocate of exercise, and so if anything, I really want to say let them go for walks when they have free time. But we have stopped that. They do not walk alone. They have to be with a senior peer when they did walk, and they typically are walking groups. So we've eliminated that, and I would imagine that the residents have already have seen that. In fact, they did concur that they, at our meeting on May 30th, that they had observed that there were no people walking the street. We have been planning now for probably almost a year and trying to receive funding to implement a fitness and wellness program at Oak House and Lake House and the Bay Ridge, our program for pregnant women. So hopefully that will accommodate my desire to have an on-walking day exercise, so we will have an exercise program for them. So we can eliminate and continue that plan of them not walking on the street. Another issue was that they weren't able to contact us directly. And we did switch our phone system a few years ago to campus dialing, and so you no longer call Oak House directly or Lake House directly, it would just ring to our main office. So we did provide, people who attended the meeting anyway, we did provide them my direct dial number and Dave Hammond, our residential treatment supervisor's cell phone number, and encouraged them anytime, day or night, if they see anything going on that they thought should not be aware of or had concerns, that they should definitely call one of us. We want our clients to be successful. We want to be good neighbors. We want the same thing they want. And so if there's anything going on, we want to know right away and we'll handle that right away. So they have our phone numbers so they can call us directly. Drug deals. One person mentioned that they observed drug dealing. This person, I believe, on Elm Street. Drug deals going on right in front of their house. I don't know if you could make an assumption that that would be Lake Geauga Center's clients, it could be anybody doing drug deals. But again, if any of that is involving our residents, we would always work with the police. If there's any criminal activity, we would always be working with the police and cooperate with them on any of those matters. We are an abstinence-based program, and the clients, by that we know drugs are alcohol. And the clients know that upon admission, and we have zero tolerance for that. So we drug test rigorously, we do it randomly and for reasonable suspicion if they come back for a visit, so we do a lot of drug testing. Unfortunately, if somebody has used drugs or alcohol, they cannot stay at our facilities. We do not just open the door and say, okay, you gotta go now. We make arrangements for them to go somewhere, so they aren't just out roaming the street if they can no longer stay in our services. Another issue was about traffic. When we built Oak House, we added 16 more beds and more staff, so yes, there was an increase in traffic when we built Oak House. And there will be an increase in traffic assuming we're building another facility. However, these are people who come to work and they stay, and they leave work, and they aren't driving back and forth and back and forth. So I believe we counted up about 8 people right now between our counselors, our supervisors, case manager, and people who are supporting who might be ready in or out. Plus we have a program assistant, one on each shift. So they would be 3 to 11 and 11 to 7 that would be driving in or out. We also have volunteers from the AA community who might pick up our residents to take them to a meeting. And that is part of our program. Many programs in other areas, they bring AA in to them, and rather than the residents going out. And I have had more residents at Oak and Lake House personally tell me that they've been to some of the other treatment programs and how much they appreciate it. They were forced to go out and meet people in the AA community to get rides for their meetings because that forced them to start meeting sober people. They started developing that foundation in the recovery community. So it's a part of our program that we really embrace and we believe in, and it's part of our philosophy as far as treatment and recovery. We have a great deal of passion about this, as you can tell, and if we can eliminate the waiting list, it would be a really wonderful thing. And I think it's great that the panel can embrace that they have this type of facility. Not every county has this this resource. So I'm hoping that the council will favor our request for this zoning change. That's all I have. Thanks.
My name is Dan Carson. I live at 9185 Woodsway Drive in Kirkland. I am a chairman of the board of directors of Lake Geauga Recovery Centers. I have been a chairman just the past 2 years. I've been on the board since 2011. I took the chairmanship when I retired from a law firm, Sparsavers and Dempsey in Cleveland. And I have a passion for what we're doing. But I want to assure you that this board also is a governing board, and we have vetted the need. We're convinced that there is a need. We are also, our board is convinced that residential treatment works, and I can testify to that. I'm in recovery myself. It permitted me to finish 50 years of law practice being in recovery. And I have a daughter who just finished 90 days at Oak House and is in one of our recovery houses at the present time. So I'm an advocate for this because treatment works. It really does. It allows people to either maintain a career or a lifestyle that's good for the community, or it allows them to get back into it. I have been, and Melody have been working with the Economic Development Office. We want to be good neighbors to Painesville. And we have our lawyers, Paul and the law director, have worked on a memorandum of understanding. And the memorandum of understanding with Lake Jago would be an evidence of our good faith here. If we can build this, we would intend to staff it commercially. The payroll would be approximately today's wages for the additional facility, about $355,000 a year. So it would provide some benefit employment-wise here. And that would be new staff. We're not using the same staff. That would be new staff going forward. We would also take commercially reasonable efforts to relocate our property for downtown in order to prevent the city to develop that entire block, on one corner of the former hospital site, and it's the city's High Point Center facility. And we would take commercially reasonable if the developer wanted to have the entire block for us to find another location and to be downtown in some other place. We've agreed to do that. And I point this out because we want to be good neighbors, but we also want to emphasize that we think this is really good for Paysville and for Lake County, the Lake Jago Recovery Center. It's not every community that has the opportunity for this kind of treatment. And residential treatment does, in fact, work. It is the best form to have. I'll keep my comments brief because you permitted our chairman to speak longer.
Instead of getting fired at Lubazov Corporation, we put them in treatment, and
very high percentage of them stayed sober. Not all of them, unfortunately, but the ones who went to treatment, went through the program, did the aftercare, stayed sober, and we kept them on the result. Because I would have been, I was one of the first ones to say, if they didn't stay sober, like, no, they said, we had zero tolerance. If they didn't stay sober, you know, we'll give you a chance. We're going to give you 13 chances. So, you know, my point is, I take people to treatment. I take them to detox. There aren't a lot of detoxes around. As Melanie said, they're usually very crowded. I mean, sometimes we can take them, you know, we take them to Cleveland somewhere, but it's just not, there's a real need for it. As you all know, there's an epidemic, opioid epidemic. I deal with a lot of heroin addicts. A lot of people are dying every day, every week in this area from fentanyl and opioid. We need a detox. When somebody's ready to go to treatment, like Melanie said, you can't say, oh, come back in 3 weeks. You gotta strike while the iron's hot. You get them when they're down. You know, you don't kick them when they're down, but you get them when they're down and say, are you ready? And if they say yes, boom, you need to get them in someplace. And then you got a chance. I traveled all over the country and all over the world for the result. I became a global IT manager. I traveled, lived in many different countries. But I went to meetings all over the place and I talked to people in the business. And, you know, I don't have statistics, and I probably wouldn't believe them anyway, but from anecdotal evidence, the Lake Geauga Recovery Center has one of the highest rates of success of anywhere. One of the reasons is because they send the people out. They make vetted alcoholics and addicts, pick them up, mentor them, take them to meetings, and they're immersed in the program. And so that's, you know, I too have a lot of passion. Thank you very much.
Can I talk?
Sure.
Okay. Kim Carlson, 749 Oak Street. I'm here because I had to do a lot of self-searching. I didn't show up to your thing that I had already decided. I have nothing against the houses. I think they're good places, so I'm all for it. What I had problems with was the house across the street and a couple of the guys that came down. And that was in 2017, early 2017. So the people that are in the places right now, they haven't given us any problems. Okay? The walking down the street, yeah. The cars.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry. The cars, yeah. They'll take care of. I did hear part of what he had talked to neighbors about. So I was glad on that. So I'm all for. I had to do a lot of soul searching. Something I said in that meeting at the zoning meeting about letting other places move there, build there for that. And why would I have a problem now? And it had nothing to do with them. It had to do with some freeloaders across the street that stayed at Mr. Stevens' house and a couple people that came down from the first, I think it was the first part of the guys. But nothing against them now. They haven't done a thing. That's all I want to say. Sorry. Thank you for listening to me.
And now it's from the council?
Yeah, I have a couple of questions.
Yes.
So, gentleman mentioned. You mentioned detox. So is this facility, I have no idea, is this facility going to be a medical facility for detox as well, or will these people come there that are pretty much recovered at this point and they're going to live there to be entered back into society, or is this going to be the start of someone's treatment?
Should I
answer?
Sure. This is the start of someone's treatment. So they would go through an intake and assessment process first. So before they start anything, they have a diagnosis, and we would determine what their level of care is and if that's the appropriate level of care. So the new facility would include what we call withdrawal management. With the way detox is to now today and with protocols for that, the medications work much faster, and so we can be doing treatment concurrently while they're going through withdrawal management.
How successful is this type of, in other words, if you've got 10 people that come in, do you have 10 people that stay in this beginning stage, or is it a revolving door? And I know it's, by case by case, I understand that, but I'm concerned with the neighborhood.
It is case by case, and so we've noticed that, we've tracked our plans for many, many years, and so people who stay over 90 days have a much, much greater rate of success of long-term sobriety. 30 days and less, not so much. So we really are trying to focus on those first 30 days to get people engaged in treatment, especially with people struggling with opiate addiction. We are using medication-assisted treatment. There's two different medications we use to help people reduce cravings and urges and helps them stay in treatment longer.
Just want to remind everybody this is not an assumption.
Then why are we here?
So the public hearing tonight is just on the rezoning. There'll be another hearing at a later date on the actual conditional use of the property. So everything that was shared was very nice about what the intentional use is, but that decision is for a later date. Tonight is just for the rezoning of the property. So the conversation should really be about what the rezoning does for the neighborhood and the contiguous of properties, and more focus on the property itself tonight. The use will be at a different time.
So then my next question, or last question, will be, you know, as I look at the minutes, we had several folks that came from Strongsville and out of town speaking how important this was and that they should be in favor of it. And then we have quite a few residents who are very concerned about the neighborhood. And we have, so if this is about the neighborhood, then how do you address their concerns? Because they've lived there longer, and they have their property, and they've been concerned about their property. We already have two, why do we need three?
Well, I went through all those concerns. So all the concerns that they raised at the Planning Commission and at the informational session, they were all pretty much the same. Water was the new concern that was brought up at the informational session. And I just a few minutes ago went through how we're addressing all those concerns. And Bill, was there a specific question?
No, okay, thank you.
I think, you know, having the availability to contact us at any time, maybe I'm hoping put their mind at ease also.
What type of the actual facility, what kind of structure are you looking to put in that?
The physical structure?
Yeah, if the zoning goes the way it's changed, what's the physical structure look like? And if have you ever been in a situation where something didn't work out and the structure was repurposed for something else later?
We have repurposed two of our facilities, but it's not because it didn't work out, it's because we were expanding.
Okay.
Our architect is here. Do you want to talk a little bit about what the structure is? Is that
give
okay?
Him a rundown.
Well, I would just add again that this is about the zoning. So again, it's a very heartfelt conversation and a lot of
but the zoning would also include though the structure that would be going on and the impact that it might have on the area.
That's the use of the property, what the possible use of the property could be is the zoning, and it could be anything. And they're not presenting, I guess I just don't want to get too bogged down in, I think what I heard about this was that it is in conformance, the request to rezone is in conformance with the way the properties are used in the area at this point in time.
Right.
And
so we put up a slide that talks about B1 business. These are the permitted uses. So these are, if it got rezoned, anything under these permitted uses could be put on this property. Anything under the conditional use could be put on the property with a conditional use permit from the Planning Commission and approval of council. So as you can see, it's something that's permitted under B1 under a conditional use permit. So let's, in general, let's just say it got rezoned tonight, they decided to step away, it's now a B1 business district. Whoever purchases it can put anything that's under the permitted uses without ever approaching us again for a conditional use permit. So those are permitted under B1. And then under conditional use, anyone can step toward Planning Commission and ask for a conditional use permit on that property. So if we focus on taking the current zoning and switching it to this zoning, forgetting about what could go there from Lake Geogga, but just focus on what could go there per our local laws, that's really what we should be focusing on, and how that relates to the neighborhood. So we can refocus on that, and then talk about the rezoning.
Right, the starting point is the master plan for the city.
Right.
That's the starting point. Is it consistent with the master plan? Next step is, is it consistent with current zoning? Then you take a look and see what's there, you know, is it consistent with the current neighborhood? You're looking at strictly as these zoning issues for tonight's purposes.
We heard from people that were for zoning out there that like to speak their opposed. Any other questions or comments from council? I'd like to get a motion to close the public hearing.
Make a motion to close the public hearing.
And a second.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
That's Gary. Okay, we'll move back into our legislation. ordinance number 130.
An ordinance amending the district map and the setback map referred to in section 1127.02 of the Gainesville Code of 1998, rezoning permanent parcel number 15A008D000020, located at 760 Oak Street, from a R1 single family district and M1 light industrial district to a B1 business residential district.
Move to adopt.
Second.
Mrs. Shoup?
Yes.
Mr. Fitzgerald?
Yes.
Mrs. DiNello?
Yes.
Mr. Augustine?
Yes.
Mr. Fodor?
Yes.
Mr. Hack?
Yes. Ordinance 1 passed. Resolution number 9, first reading.
A resolution declaring certain real estate owned by the city as no longer needed for municipal purposes, authorizing the city manager to sell or lease said real estate to MCP2 LLC and declaring an emergency.
In 2017, the City Council passed legislation for the sale or lease of land at 1170 North State Street for the purposes of manufacturing, which, as you know, is a vital component of our economic development. The company at that time that this agreement was in place for was unsuccessful in securing their licensing. This new resolution is the same resolution that was passed in August 24th meeting, but with a new company name, MC2P LLC. This resolution will allow the city manager to enter into a one-year auction agreement for up to 3 acres with MC2P LLC for the lease or sale of land at a sale or lease price of $45.5 per acre. This auction will allow MC2P LLC to move forward in their efforts with the State of Ohio Department of Commerce to relocate their approved medical marijuana processing facility to the city of Gainesville. There's an anticipated 20 jobs that would be created over the three-year period with a $1 million payroll. The company has applied for a highly competitive application process to acquire a processing licensing in Ohio. MC2 Processing LLC was successful in its bid to acquire a processing license and is one of 40 recipients of a processor license in the state of Ohio. The CEO and founder, Brian Scotzi, is here today as well.
Sir, do you want to speak?
Thank you, Kathy. Brian Scattese, do you want me to say my address?
Yes.
Brian Scattese, 11560 Holden Ridge Road, Chardon, Ohio. So I think Kathy did a pretty good job of summarizing what we intend to use the property for. As you know, medical marijuana is a process that's been approved and has its purposes with helping a number of things. There's 21 of them that the Ohio is approved, and this facility will be a pharmaceutical grade facility, 8,000 square feet, security. State cameras will be on 24/7. In the proposed area, it's already fenced in. We plan to also put additional fencing and security in, approved by the state. So what a processing plant does is it takes medical marijuana that's grown, it purchases that from growers, and it puts it through manufacturing machines that extract out the medical marijuana. And then that gets put into suppositories and patches and things that are used for medical purposes. We don't sell anything to the general public. There will be no general public there on the property. Everything is sold to a state-approved dispensary. There's 60 of them around the state of Ohio. We will be able to provide our products to them. I'm happy to answer any questions that anyone has.
So in purchasing grown marijuana and having it brought in, how does that, what kind of vehicles does that come in?
Yeah, it's a great question. So these are standard vehicle vans that where you can stand up in. They are with armed guards, and these are the grow facilities. There's one in this lake called Buckeye Relief. And if we were to purchase our product from there or material from them, they would deliver it. It would look just like an old van to you. There's no markings on it. But they have to have two armed guards in there, and they have to take different paths to get to where they're going so that there's no tracing patterns and trying to intercept. And then they would bring that into a lock facility, so you know, we have a facility where the door would open, and they would come in, the door would shut, and then it's a lock facility. There's what they call man locks. You can have them for a man, but you can also have the same thing for a vehicle. And once they're in there, they can't get out without proper security and authorization. So they could be in a lock right in there if it was something that
is the product going out by the same principle?
It does, yes.
And then when you talk about the different routes going in, would the facility have more than one entrance, or would it just be one entrance and they just come from different pathways to that one entrance?
It would be just one entrance into the facility and different pathways they would take to get to the, you know, the same couple streets that lead to that facility.
One of my concerns when we talked about this for the last organization that wanted to something there was that the residential streets that these pathways would be on. So they, you know, I can think of four different routes off the top of my head, all through residential neighborhoods. So that concerns me.
What is your concern?
That these vehicles require this amount of high security, and they are traveling through residential areas. So should something go down, much like with the Brinks truck, we could be talking about a fire or something like that on a residential street. That's concerning.
Does specifically facilitate 6 inches in residential areas, that whether it's vacant or not. So we will now be enforcing it at 6 inches in residential areas, because that's how I interpret the local law. So there's no need to change the language, we just need to increase our enforcement.
So we will enforce it, and the inspectors have been informed.
Do we have a gradual break-in period so that all of a sudden?
We are very considerate, especially when it's pouring down rain for 3 weeks straight and you can't get in there to mow your lawn. We take extra steps to make sure we're communicating with those who's gone there too long. But it does get to a point where we have to get it cut at some point. But because we're enforcing it differently, we will make sure that those people understand the new enforcement prior to being cited.
Will that mean new letters? I know we only sent out one letter, but now that they're changing this to some of these areas that have residential, they were expecting 12.
It's the same letter, regardless, because we're just enforcing, we're enforcing what is existing as...
Right, but I'm saying, I've got a vacant property. You sent me a letter that said 12 inches, I'm in my brain 12 inches. There's only one letter, and so we repeat, we go back, our inspectors go back and see it's now 6. As the owner of that residential lot, my brain says it's 12. So I'm saying, on some of those circumstances, will we send them a new letter to say it's no longer 12?
Everybody receives the same letter, whether it's residential or commercial, so there would be...
So what she's saying is, now that we're enforcing it digitally, can we give them a warning prior to having our mower go out and mow it?
We can, I mean,
I just think that makes sense. I'm not great for anyone, but
It is more work, but it's our job to communicate that, so we will communicate.
We will notify. And we appreciate what we're giving you job security.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
What is the difference between a vacant property and a tall grass and a wooded lot? Like, to me, vacant means there's nothing on it, it's just empty, and all that we have is grass. But how do you determine who has got a wooded lot, and then how tall is the grass allowed to be in the wooded lot?
It's, I would have to talk with the inspectors, but I would assume, typically on a wooded lot, if it's further back, if it's further in the woods and the entire lot is wooded, we look at that. But if there's a portion of the lot where the weeds are in excess, then we definitely address it. Or there's an area along the right of way that looks like it has been mowed in the past. For example, we have that over on Hickory. There's a portion in front of the residential wooded lot that has grass approximately 20 feet back. We enforce that. And we actually require them to mow that.
6 inches. Any other requests? You want to note or pull this out though?
You can take it off.
Okay.
Take it off.
All right. I'm going to give a department presentation here. Parks and Recreation.
Our
to go visit the local metro parks. They're listed right there, their top favorite metro parks, though, are the top three, Chatham Forest, Penitentiary, Glen, and Home Phase Wine and Heart. The Chatham Forest, the children like to hike up to the sea overlook, where they can see downtown Cleveland. They think that's just really neat. Penitentiary Glen, besides the hikes that they go on, they have an outdoor play area where they can build forts and little huts out of bamboo, and so they enjoy that. And at the Home Phase Wine and Heart, the river is quiet. They go on the river, they look for crayfish and frogs and stuff. Tuesdays we spend down at Red Park. We do different activities that we have there. Favorite activity is fishing. Children love to fish at Red Park, so that's their favorite group activity. Besides different group games like softball or kickball, things like that. Wednesdays we go to the Martin Pool and Mender, and that's a nice break for the children because of the fact that we don't have any water facility here. And you'd be surprised how many children go to camp and have never experienced these things. Even on some of the field trips they've gone. So it's a really enjoyable thing. Thursdays are special event day when they do a different theme each time. This week's special event day is every water, so they're planning on doing slip and slides, water loop games. They have some type of tubes that they're not guns, but they suck in the water and they have a battle with water. So the kids really like these special event days. Yep. And then Friday's our field trip day. We are going this week to the Pioneer Water Band, which is one of the popular field trips for the children. But again, as I said, there's many children who've never been to the zoo, never been to a lot of these places, so they really did enjoy the opportunity to go on to a field trip. And then we just put in some of the campus spots. The children are kind of funny. At the end of the year last year, some of their accomplishments were, and I hope to be here next year, not that great late. Thankfully, always at the best field trip they've ever been on. And actually, this particular child had been with our camp since he was six, and we stayed with them when he was 12, so we really enjoyed that field trip. The children asked to come back, and the parents are anxious for them to come back, enjoy themselves, and again, they're outside and making new friends. They're not sitting for video games.
Any questions, sir?
I have one comment.
Yes.
You can ask them in your presentation, but thank you for brush hogging that base. Oh, man, when I remember I saw it all up, and then I drove our tables there, it's gone. It's like, oh, okay, thank you.
Oh,
How many children do you have?
We have like 48.
48
of us. Because of the bus, we need to get a second bus. It's not feasible unless I normally get at least 20 more kids to pay for another bus.
Congratulations. So I just want to say both my children went through the camps full time, and they really loved it. It's a great experience for
them. I look at it.
I
like the networking with the people at these schools for lunches and all of that, and really appreciate it. And actually, I'm not doing it.
I was also going to say the same thing as Lori. The networking with Kansas City Schools is amazing. I drop Lisa off every day to a completely fenced-in area with a gym, swing sets. She can go inside, she can go in the gym, she can go in the art rooms and watch movies. And she loves all the counselors and everybody involved. It's so much fun.
I agree. It's wonderful that the partnership we made with the schools. Thank you.
Administrator reports, law director.
I'm not doing
it. I'm not sitting after.
I have a further report.
Clerk of Council.
The next regular council meeting will be held Monday, July 15th at 7:30. The farmer's market has started and runs Thursdays through October 10th, noon to 4. The car crew started and runs every Friday through September 27th, 5 to 9. The pharmacy is June 23rd, 10 a.m. to 4 in the JFS parking lot. And the next upcoming first Friday is July 5th and it is the dog days of summer. That's it.
Thank you. What's your comments, Nick?
I just have, thank you for everybody that's coming to speak today, but I just have one additional comment. It was in regards to our first public visitor, Mr. Baxter from Hoyt Street. He had mentioned the firearm incidents in our neighborhood, in our community, and I just want to bring it to everybody's attention that council did just push forward to proceed with the levy today. That would go towards the police levy, and in the safety committees, Chief Waterman had brought with the administration and everybody else to our attention that it's been a huge, huge ticket on his list to punch, that we would be looking into getting crime cameras systems, which would also involve license plate readers, and that would really help pinpointing down where, you know, this is happening and where these people are going, where they're coming from. And I thought that was just a great comment today for what we had on our agenda. So,
bravo.
Thank you.
Thank you.
About a year and a half ago, we were talking about points of sale. And I think some of the other communities, there was a lawsuit that was going in place. If I'm not mistaken, I was just wondering if anybody had heard where that was venturing.
I have not heard a conclusion on the lawsuit. I know that those who had point of sale were still continuing with it until the law changed, okay. But I do not have.
Would that be a little job security for our legal counsel to investigate in the next day or two?
We can look into it.
Thank you. Christine?
I don't really have anything but one personal item. I wanted to give a shout out to two Painesville residents who are on Nick's board, Jessica and Megan Cook. I dropped my wallet in Aldi's parking lot, and they got it back to my house before I even got back to my house. So the Good Samaritan, Pay It Forward, which I already did, and I plan to do that, but I just told those ladies, I can't believe that they actually got to my house. And my husband says, then my husband texts me. I break the phone rings, and I'm looking at him going, Bobby, you want to pick that up? He's going, I lost my wallet. I pick the phone up and I go, hi, Joe. He goes, I have your wallet in my hand. I was like, whoa. So anyway, shout out to Jessica and Megan Cook. Thank you very much.
Lori?
Hey, I have a Good Samaritan story too, which is kind of interesting. And that is that I have this island in the front of my property that has got ivy in it, and the ivy's pretty thick, and so, you know, in the spring and in the fall, you're trying to rake out all of those leaves, and I was about exhausted trying to keep up with it, and getting the leaves out this spring, and three young gentlemen were walking down the street playing together. They looked like they'd be between the ages of 12 and 13, and the smallest of the three said, hey, can I help? I love doing this stuff. And he just picked up a rake and started raking. We did that thing down in about 20 minutes. And they helped carry all the leaves back into the woods and everything, so they were wonderful. And I hope they walk down the street again very soon while I'm working in the yard. I do want to thank all folks that came out tonight in support of the Recovery Center. And I want to thank all of you for all of the work you do. It's very meaningful work. There's nothing more valuable in this world than people. I think people are the world's greatest commodity. So thank you for investing your time, and I look forward to seeing how this all unfolds for you. I also wanted to congratulate you on your success rate for recovery. I think that's a wonderful topic to be able to, I don't want to say boast, but to proclaim and say that you're really making a difference. So thank you for all of that. I know that the rain has been really tough on people with their yards. I know I've got mine. I have a big industrial mower. I've got 3 acres, and I've gotten stuck twice in the mud with my mower, and I had to have my whole deck washed down and cleaned up. And you don't think you're going into it, and then bam, you're in it. I have not.